seems my own experience is mirror that to quite a degree, and I'm concerned about that.
Mr. Take that. Perhaps, again, and I'll accept that our communication is, we just recently, because of our business case manager, how many jobs did he say that in the last 2 years that he, you know?
I remember it was 733 jobs in the last.
These are jobs that objectively have been created, certainly within our retail business, as you know, has dropped. But by the time you add in, whether it be the Fonterra or the O'Reilly Hotel, or you add in Blue Pacific Minerals, or you start looking at farm conversions, in terms of that work and those numbers, you know, and our business case manager, the police there, said these are the jobs that have been created, and that didn't include, you know, evil things like the 600 working at Fonterra. And so that, which will be more. So that in terms of that in our retail, you're certainly right, our retail, but sitting out from there, in terms of business growth, in fact, Infometrics actually put our GDP growth as one of the highest councils in the country. So we've actually had some of that growth. Councillor Shattock, we had your hand up.
Yes, I did. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Simpson. You're talking about us deferring the money that we have budgeted for a whole new airfield, and leaving it for 2 years, I think, and then doing investigations. You've talked in the past about decommissioning. What do you mean?
Not decommissioning.
No.
Yeah, it's a thing called delisting.
And what does that do? Yeah.
That simply means that the airfield has a different status from the perspective of what regulations and laws apply. And one of the problems is if you want to run the airfield as a drone school, it becomes very difficult if it is a listed airfield, because only you have to have certain qualifications and things to fly. There are a lot more restrictions on what you can do in respect to using unmanned aircraft at a listed airfield, which means it becomes less attractive to the industry. If you delist it, it can still be used. People can still come and go.
So it's,
It's just a different legal status, and that means that it opens it up to much more opportunity. And the reason I say a two-year hiatus on that resealing is it would give us an opportunity to try and attract drone businesses for 2 years. At the end of 2 years, if none of them had come or it wasn't really working and general aviation had taken off again, then you've still got the option of relisting it and running it as a full-size airfield. But if things continue the way they are and there's no evidence whatsoever that the trend is going to change, in 2 years' time, I doubt there'll be virtually any aircraft at the airfield, and unmanned aviation will have grown by that huge amount and will have missed the train.
So
is
that,
thank you. That's
good reading, in which sitting in there, but if we went down the drone path, at some stage, because of the state of the airfield, we're going to have to reseal it.
Do we have to? Because it's, if no one's using it, it's
no, if the drone industry came, we're going to have to do something to an airfield, to the strip at some stage.
We are or not? Well, not.
If the drone industry came
in
2 years' time and it was going well,
yeah,
we would be looking at doing something on the runway.
Well, you wouldn't need to, because it wouldn't be used as a full-size runway in that respect. So it's no longer an expenditure that you need to make, because if it's not being used, it's not an asset. It's a liability.
Because, and again, I accept the communication, that in terms of our off-class broadband, in which we have been in discussion with the government, trying to get things here, we're actually, back in February, we were actually rated 20th out of 34 in New Zealand, and we actually had an uptake of over 15%, with the national average for uptake was actually 18%. So we're actually working on that ultra-fast broadband, and if we can bring off, as we work with the DHB, we will be one of the leaders. So work is taking place very hard within the ultra-fast. Now, we don't get that information out, and I think that is a fault of ours, but, Whanganui is at 14.7, and we're 14.9, so that we haven't managed to sell that as well as we could. So
we missed the opportunity when we were one of only two towns in the entire country with ultra-fast, which would have brought in high-tech companies to come here, because
that we have discussed that with the government in terms of that, in which, as a council, we made a proposal to two core companies to come into Tokoroa, and unfortunately, they both decided to, with government assistance, go to Wellington.
Now, there should have been a public announcement, a press release, that covered the period in the media, leveraging our position so that every business read that, and the ones that wanted to come programming, whatever they might want to come. We don't do a very good job of selling. selling ourselves. We don't market ourselves well.
Simpson, sorry, and I said 733 jobs, well, it was 370 odd, so I got that wrong, so I'll just
how many, sorry?
It's about 370.
Yeah.
370, thank you.
Yeah.
700. But you talked about delisting the airport. If you were running a drone school there, you would need accredited instructors, I would assume, which would meet those standards around the so is delisting actually an issue? Because surely you would have people with the right accreditation to manage that.
It is an issue in so much as, to quote the Price Waterhouse report, the PwC report states and acknowledges the importance of and value of RC model activities to the drone industry. Right? Now, one of the things we need, in this town, a school student cannot fly a drone anywhere in this town without the risk of being prosecuted by CAA because of our bylaws. So we cannot get our young people on the first step of that ladder unless they can do that stuff legally in the town. And the airport restricts that.
So delisting would be the step of that?
That would be a first step.
All right, okay. Yeah, time is up.
So if it's delisted, that's 3-4 k's radius, that would not be...
That would no longer apply.
That would no longer apply.
And the farmers could use drones without having to have all that certification, and it makes it more accessible to the very businesses on which we rely for our economy.
Well, thank you for this information, and it will be as we...
I want to ask a question. Yes, Mr. Simpson. One thing for sure, you've been consistent over the last 3 years that I'm aware of, and that's this crusade to delist the airfield. So I congratulate you on your persistence. The other thing that seems to have been consistent is this story of people being rebuffed and turned away by the council. I got that story from you when I visited you late last year on one matter you put before the CEO, and I just want to correct in public the impression that you're putting out of that stage, that he ignored your email and did not do anything about it. He made contact with the firm.
Which firm are we talking about?
I think it was BEA, one of the
systems, yeah.
And went through the process of contacting him and had an exchange with us. So it is not true.
I was told he received no reply.
Well,
which was correct.
I assure you that.
I emailed the gentleman, never got a response.
So it wasn't an exchange of emails then, was it? So
well,
he emailed me initially, and there was a return to that.
But there was no
which offered help and support and so on,
but
I never heard from him.
Okay.
I don't want to get into a debate about it, but the fact is that you are saying you're getting lots of approaches, but because there's a brick wall at the council, you're not passing them on. I believe you're actually not doing your duty as a good citizen of this area by taking that attitude. And I would refer anybody to come here, document the fact that they came here and they spoke to whoever, and then this council can follow up with those officers for not doing their job. But it hasn't been happening. I've done some checking. Nobody has come here to try and start up a drone business.
No, and the occasions when I have approached this in the past for my own expansions have been rebuffed as well. And I mean, I can't... The problem is that council is... status quo on the airfield, there doesn't seem to be any. You can't just say, well, come to us. You've got to welcome people, encourage them to come. There's a whole difference between sitting there waiting for something to happen and making stuff happen. We are not making stuff happen. We're lazy. We're sitting here waiting for people to come. We need to roll out, welcome back, and let people know,
sir,
hey, this is a place to come.
I thank you for that. In terms of the airfield, Fonterra are here because of a proactive approach by council. Blue Pacific Minerals are here because of a proactive response by council. Okarari Hotel has taken over because of a proactive response to council. In your area, it may not have been as proactive as you like, but the proactive nature of this council seeking new business over a wide range of things, going right back to farm, forestry conversions, has been one of proactivity, and as you yourself mentioned, the proactivity is extended to our trade training, which is probably leading the country in terms of trading. And the logistic from there is a new venture. It is a proactive council that is looking. It may not have approached in your particular area as well as you like, but don't label all of council's activities as not being proactive.
I just refer you to the visitor solutions report that you're relying on.
That's the rely. That's on retail business. Yes,
it
sir.
Doesn't say retail. It says business.
Mr. Simpson, as you go, jet modellers, do they need a listed or airport, or can
they
fly with a...
Sorry? They benefit from having it unlisted.
Unlisted.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.